We've covered pseudonymization and anonymization earlier in the course, but it's important for us to discuss these more in depth. We've previously covered it's nearly impossible to make your personal identity anonymous. We are registered and part of the system. We have social security numbers, we have birth certificates, we pay taxes, and have jobs. But this doesn't mean we can't hide or separate the non-necessities from ourselves. So how do we do this? Go Incognito and all of our other projects that we do are made available completely free to you. One of the ways we're able to do this for a living and offer it for free is through people who are supporting our work. So thank you to all of our patrons over on Patreon, and thank you to our privacy supporters on YouTube. If you want to help enable us spread privacy to the masses, make sure to check out our Patreon and join, as well as becoming a privacy supporter on YouTube. Not only are you helping our cause, but you can gain access to behind the scenes, like how this lesson was created, badges in the YouTube comments, and other cool perks. We really do appreciate anything you can do to help us out, and thank you for your support. To recap, pseudonymization is the creation of an alias or ghost identity. Pseudonyms are completely legal as long as you're not using them to defraud someone else. They allow you to sideload information to aliases not tied to you, which is useful when services or people are requesting information that doesn't necessarily need to be yours. Anonymization, though, involves making sure something you're doing is tied to no identity. The most common way of accomplishing this is by blending a group of people together so no one user is unique. This is exactly what Tor does. It is built from the ground up to make you look like everybody else using it. To sum up how you use the two concepts, I would recommend you anonymize any traffic that doesn't require an account with Tor and other anonymization tools discussed throughout the course. If something does require an account, but you don't want it to be tied to your identity, pseudonyms are normally the way to go. The idea is to keep your pseudos and anonymous sessions completely separate from your true identity. Sounds easy enough, but how do you make a pseudonym? Let's make one together with the master of pseudonyms, Roger Smith the Alien.
And I'm the head of the political science department at Harvard, thank you very much.
Political science? You should be an economics professor.
What? No, I make my own backstory. Besides, I freaking hate economics.
But before we do that, remember the one and only golden rule. Your pseudonyms must not be tied to your personal identity. First, we need to figure out what the pseudo is for. What information does he or she need to have, and how in-depth does it need to be? Let's start with the name. Since this will function as just a general purpose pseudo that doesn't need to be a unique person, let's give it a degree of anonymity. We'll pick a very common name to blend in, something like Brian Smith. Now, Roger needs a form of communication, and this will vary depending on what service he's trying to access. If it's an online survey, he'll need an email. If it's Google, maybe also a phone number. He needs to form a communication method that isn't tied to him. We've previously covered services in the course like Temp Mail, Gorilla Mail, Free Phone Num, iNumber, Burner, and Shuffle, as well as prepaid phone sims. There's many ways to get an essentially anonymous phone number. Up next, Brian needs an origin story. Is he married? Does he have kids? Where did he grow up? How old is he? If Brian is only a digital pseudo, he can fake all of this pretty easily. If Brian goes out into the real world though, some parts of Brian's story may need to match with Roger's story. You can't say that Brian is 80 years old when Roger looks 25. People may have some trouble believing him. If Roger wanted to go more in depth, he could give Brian his own shipping address using a PO box or private mailbox separate from his. If Brian needs to make a payment, maybe for a VPN, it needs to be done in a way not tied to Roger. We covered how to do this earlier in the course. And that's Brian Smith, one pseudo. I'd recommend creating multiple pseudos for different purposes. They don't need to be that complex. Maybe you have one for online surveys, one for spam, one for Jamba Juice, and one for Craigslist. The sky's the limit. If you need help with creativity, Fake Name Generator is a great resource. Pseudos can also be used in an anonymous fashion to layer them. You can have a pseudonym that only lives in Tor sessions, so you're utilizing anonymity to hide a pseudonym to hide yourself. The sky here's the limit, and before wrapping things up, remember the golden rule. Your pseudonyms must not be tied to your personal identity. And that's the lesson. It'll give you a lot of freedom with different ways you can sideload information that would otherwise be tied to your personal identity. I want to thank Roger Smith for helping me out, and I will see you in the next lesson, Shopping Safely. Thanks for watching.